نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهدي الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله سيد المرسلين وخاتم النبيين ورحمة للعالمين وصلى الله على آله الطاهرين الذين أذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا أوصيكم عباد الله ونفسي بتقوى الله I would like to begin with talking about one aspect of the Holy Qur'an, which is our scripture, that is our holy book. That when you study the Qur'an, you will notice that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions many stories of the nations of the past and the prophets who came to them. Many good examples, one many, many negative examples. And we had to realize that the stories in the Qur'an are not just for the sake of storytelling. You know, it's not something that you read and then go to sleep. It is actually the stories are there to keep us awake and to reflect on them and use that as a way of, you know, reforming ourselves, amending our ways, so that we do not commit the same mistakes that the other nations had done in the past. And take example, the positive ones from the previous nations, and move forward. The reason why I'm mentioning it that way, because if it was just a book of stories, you know, you will not see that, you know, the stories are not in one place. The story of, for example, Prophet Musa alayhi salam is scattered all over the Qur'an. Not even the sequence or the chronological order. Maybe his old age would be first, his, you know, childhood would be somewhere else. And so this is where we come to realize that Qur'an is not a book of history. If it was a book of history, then it would have gone in a chronological order in the sequence starting from Adam, for example. But it doesn't do that way. And this is where we come to realize that the stories have been selected by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Sometimes it's the same story. In one place it might come in a very brief form, and then you will see the same story is there somewhere else in a more elaborate form. And there are reasons for that, and that the reason is very simple, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses the stories not for storytelling, rather to give us an example. You know, you had to look at those examples and then learn lessons from it. Interestingly, the only exception to this rule about the story being in chronological order, in sequence, in one place, is only one story. And that is the story of Prophet Yusuf alayhi salam in Surah Yūsūf. There it flows one after another, and the entire surah is mostly about him. And in that surah at the end, the last ayat, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala explains why he has given the stories to us. When he says, لَقَدْ كَانَ فِي قَصَصَهِمْ عِبَرَةٌ لِأُولِي الْأَلْبَابِ In these stories of the nations and the prophets who came before, there is ibra. In Urdu and Farsi we say, or Gujarati we say ibrat. Ibratun li'ulil albab. There is ibrat for the people who have intelligence and mind. What is ibrat? You know, the simple translation would be that this is a warning or a lesson for the people who have intelligence, who are people who have minds. You know, they should reflect on it. And if you look at the literal meaning there, you know, this basically is talking about the concept of connecting the past to the present. In Arabic, even the ma'bar is used for bridge. you know, you go from one point to another. And so basically the stories, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, you look at the stories of the past, but build a bridge from that story to your present and see what you learn from that example. And this is what we have to keep in our mind, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then says, وَمَا كَانَ حَدِيثًا يُفْتَرَى. These stories that I mentioned to you in the Qur'an, Allah says these are not stories, you know, and narrations just fabricated. وَلَكِنْ تَصْدِيقُ الَّذِي بَيْنَ يَدَيْهِ. This is a book which confirms the truth which was there before in Injil, in Torah, and Zabur, and the other books before. وَتَفْصِيلَ لِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ. And this is this explanation for everything. وَهُدًا وَرَحْمَةً لِقَوْمٍ يُؤْمِنُونَ. It is a guidance and mercy for the people who believe. Keeping in mind that we are in the month of Jamadi al-Ula, and then Jamadi al-Thani is going to come close. You know, let me just talk about one story. And this is from Surah Ali Imran about Lady Maryam, alayha salam, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, you know, he doesn't even talk about Maryam is just the mother of Isa alayhi salam. You know, there is a whole chapter named after her, but Allah in Quran even talks about her own birth. In Surah Ali Imran, actually, where he talks about how the mother of Maryam had met the Nazr, that I would like to dedicate this child who is in my womb to the service of the temple. And the norm was that, you know, it was the boys who were sent to be dedicated as servants of the temple. And when the girl was born, it was an issue. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, you know, I knew that this was a girl. Don't worry, you fulfill your nadr. You know, there was kind of a competition among the heads of the temple, the holiest sanctuary of the Jewish people in Jerusalem. And finally, they had a draw, and it came in the name of Prophet Zakaria. Zakaria was also an uncle of Maryam. وَكَفَّلَهَا Zakaria. Zakaria became the custodian. And this is ayat number 37 from Surah Ali Imran. And he placed her in a place which is known as al-mihrab in the Qur'an, the most, you know, sacred area, a room where nobody was allowed to enter there. Only Zakaria would go. كلما دخل عليها زكريا المحراب, you know, whenever Zakaria would go into that sanctuary where Maryam had been placed by him, وجد عندها رزقا. Prophet Zakaria is a prophet, remember, not just an ordinary person. He would find food with her, which he didn't bring in, and nobody else was allowed to come in there. And this is where the Qur'an narrates the story. قَالَ يَا مَرْيَمْ أَنَّ لَكِ هَذِهِ. Oh Maryam, where did this food come from? Where did this come to you? And the response was, قَالَتْ هُوَ مِنْ عِنْدِ اللَّهِ. She responded by saying, this is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَرْضُقُ مَنْ يَشَاءَ بِغَيْرِ حِسَابٍ. If Allah wants to bless someone, He would bless them without any measure. You know, and this is where we come to realize that Maryam, in that childhood, under the custody of Zakaria, in the most sacred place she is there, she has a custodian who is provided, who is providing everything that she needs there. Yet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose to bless Maryam. Then you have everything, but still I will send you, you know, the food from Jannah, from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is where we have to realize that, you know, sometimes we, when we talk about the special blessings that Allah has for His chosen ones, when we talk about the Anbiya or Mursaleen, our Prophet or the Imams, you know, sometimes we say, well, you know, this is maybe Eastern stories. These are all exaggeration. And we immediately deny it because it doesn't go with our liberal, you know, secular, scientific way of looking at things. you do realize there is another realm of spirituality, a metaphysical realm where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is actually the master of the whole universe. And we cannot deny this concept of miracles. We cannot deny this concept that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He chooses someone, you know, He can bless them the way He wants. You know, when you look at, for example, the story of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, well, Jibreel showed him a special tree, and he took a fruit from that and gave to the Prophet. Very good smell, good taste. And as the narration goes on, when he came back to Khadija salawatullah alayha, thereafter, you know, Fatima al-Zahra salawatullah alayha comes to this dunya. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, according to the story in the Qur'an itself in Surah Al-Imran, is sending food for Maryam, who already has the arrangements made, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was preparing her to become the mother of a miracle in the form of Isa ibn Maryam. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to do the same thing with Muhammad and Khadija, in order to prepare them for the viladat of Fatima al-Zahra salawatullah alayha, there is no ghulu or exaggeration here. If you put the stories together, then it becomes more easier to, you know, understand this. And this is where we see in our narrations, you know, the Prophet, of course, Fatima was the daughter. But there are some narrations where the wives used to say that, well, yes, she is your daughter, but whenever she comes, you know, many times we see that you actually, you know, smell her. And this is where the Prophet says, فَإِذَا أَنَا اشْتَقْتُ إِلَى الْجَنَّةِ He talks about the story of Mi'raj, and then he says, and whenever I have this desire of the fragrance of Jannah, أَدْنَيْتُهَا, I pull her closer to me, فَشَمِتُ رِيحَ الْجَنَّةِ, and I can feel the fragrance of Jannah, فَهِيَ رَوْحَانٌ حَوْرَاءٌ إِنْسِيَّةٌ, she is actually a heavenly human person. Salawat. This is where we are talking about Ibrah, connecting the past to the what we have in our history, in our narration, in our understanding of the Qur'an. In Ahsan al-Hadith, Kitab Allah al-Aziz, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, wal-Asr, inna al-insana lafi khusr, illa al-lazina amanu wa'amalu al-salihat wa tawasaw bil-haq wa tawasaw bil-sabr. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله الذي لا إله إلا هو الحليم الكريم غافر الذنب وقابل التوبة وهو الغفور الرحيم ونشهد أن لا إله إلا هو العتوف للعباد بجوده والعواد المذنبين بحلمه ونشهد أن محمدا نبيه وحبيبه سيد المرسلين وشفيع المظلمين ورحمة للعالمين صلى الله عليه وآله الداعين إلى سبيل الله بالحكمة والموعظة الحسنة قادة الأمم وأولياء النعمة ومعدن الرحمة أوصيكم عباد الله بتوبة ما سلف من ذنوبكم. Since I talked about the story of Lady Maryam عليه السلام, let me, you know, continue with that same surah, Al Imran, ayat 49, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about her son, Isa ibn Maryam. And it's interesting, well, the quotation is there in complete, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about what, you know, Isa says to his people, أَنِّي قَدْ جِئْتُكُمْ بِعَيَةٍ مِّن رَبِّكُمْ. When he wanted to prove that, you know, I am the Rasul and the Nabi, he says, I have come to you from your Lord with a proof. And what is my proof? أَنِّي أَخْلُقُ لَكُمْ مِنَ الطِّينَ. I will basically make for you an image of a bird from the clay. Not only that I will make it, it's not that I'm a good, you know, clay master or something. No, and then he says, فَعَنْفُقُ فِيهِ, and I'm going to then breathe into it, and it actually will turn into a real flying bird. Not a mechanical one. You know, we are talking about real. بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ, with the permission and the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَأُبْرِئُ الْأَكْمَهَ وَالْعَبْرَسَ, and then he says that, you know, I heal the blind and the lepers. وَأُحْيِي الْمَوْتَ بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ, and I bring the dead back to life with the will and the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَأُنَبِّئُكُمْ بِمَا تَأْكُلُونَ وَمَا تُدَخِّرُونَ فِي بُيُوتِكُمْ, and I will let you know, I can inform you of what you ate today. I wasn't there present. So for me, what you were eating in the morning, for example, is ghayb. But I'll be able to tell you what you were eating. And I can even let you know, if you want, if you ask me and challenge me, what you have hoarded your wealth inside your home. إِنَّ فِي ذَٰلِكَ لَآيَةً لَكُمْ إِن كُنْتُمْ مُؤْمِنِينَ. These are the signs of my truth if you are believers. And so we see here, you know, four examples that he brings up. Number one, creating of this bird from the clay, which turns into a true, you know, real flying bird. Number two, this power of shafa that Allah had given to him, the healing power, you know, healing the blind and the lepers. And number three, which is the most difficult one, that he brings the dead back to life. In the first and the second example, he uses the word bi'ithnillah. When he talks about the second and the fourth, he doesn't use those terms. Why? It is all by idhna of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But he just wants to make sure that you don't consider me to be your Lord. I have the power given from him, but I am not your Lord. But the reality is that, yes, Allah has given him power to create an image of the bird and make them into a living bird. He has the power of healing the blind and the lepers. He has the power of bringing the dead back to life. And he has the knowledge of ilm al-ghayb. Allah has given him access to that. And whenever he says, bi'idhnillah, this is to be understood as an ongoing, you know, implied concept that whenever miracles happen, it happens by the individuals, but ultimate power lies with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the awliya, the anbiya, the a'imma are not independent of Allah's power. But they have been given that power. And so this is not ghulu. Ghulu and exaggeration is when you say that Allah is retired. It's nothing to do with this dunya now. It's only the anbiya and the a'imma, for example, they manage everything. No, that will be ghulu. But if you realize that, no, whatever happens, they are still dependent of the power and the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there is no problem in believing in the power that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given, especially to the Prophet of Islam, who is the last but the best of all the messengers and the prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Salawat. You know, it's become a very fashionable these days to just quote one ayat in isolation, out of context. As you see, there is an ayat where our Prophet is saying, I don't have ilm al-ghayb. But there are other ayat also. Actually, I have very extensive chapter on my book, Shiaism, Imamat and Vilayat, written 20 years ago, where we have brought all these ayat together. And even the decisive statement of Allah Tabatabai, when he says that when you put all these ayats together, what it means that when the Prophet says, quoted in the Qur'an, that I don't have ilm al-ghayb, it means I don't have ilm al-ghayb independent of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But it doesn't mean that he doesn't have access to the ilm al-ghayb and the knowledge of the unseen according to the will and the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we have to, you know, look at all the ayat together and not just come with one ayat. Oh, I have seen this, and throw it to the public who are all then confused all the time. You know, and this is the reality we realize that the stories of the Qur'an are not just stories. You know, these are there to understand our own aqidah, our own history, and our own present, so that we can chart our future on solid ground as far as our deen and madhab is concerned. Salawat. اللهم صل على سيد المرسلين والشفيع المذنبين نبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم وعلى إمام المتقين وعمير المؤمنين علي بن أبي طالب صلوات الله عليه وعلى سيدة نساء العالمين سيدتنا فاطمة بنت رسول الله صلوات الله عليها وعلى سيد الشباب أهل الجنة الحسن المجتبى والحسين الشهيد بكربلاء عليهم الصلاة والسلام وعلى أئمة المسلمين علي بن الحسين ومحمد بن علي وجعفر بن محمد وموسى بن جعفر وعلي بن موسى ومحمد بن علي وعلي بن محمد والحسن بن علي عليهم الصلاة والسلام اللهم صل على مولانا الحجة بن الحسن صاحب العصر والزمان ما حي أصار البدء والطغيان هادم أبنية الشرك والنفاق حاسد فر البغي والشقاق صلوات الله وسلامه عليه وعلى آباء الكرام ما اتصلت الليالي والأيام اللهم عجل فرج وصح المخرج واكحل ناظرنا بنظرة منا إليه واجعلنا من المستشهدين بين يديه اللهم اجعلنا ممن يذكر فتنفعه الذكرى إن الله يعمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون